Thank you very much, Nico, for the kind introduction. Thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk. I'm trying to figure out how to... Okay, wonderful. So again, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm really delighted to be telling you about a topic that I'm very passionate about, which is developing machine learning methods for medicine and healthcare. And when you see the name of this presentation, you may just think that this is very applied work where we take off-the-shelf machine learning methods and we just apply them to medicine and healthcare. But hopefully what I'm going to convince you today with this presentation, it is that quite the opposite is true. As a matter of fact, medicine and healthcare, building tools that are truly useful in medicine and healthcare, requires us to have new ways of thinking about problems we thought we understood well. And today I'm going to illustrate that with the case of time series and time series prediction and forecasting, which is a topic that has been looked at for many, many years, inclusively in the area that I'm coming from, signal processing. And I'm going to discuss how actually, if it is to solve complex problems in medicine and healthcare, we need to develop new ways of thinking and new machine learning methods. So rather than seeing this topic of medicine and healthcare just as an applied area, which of course is a very important area because we need to try to empower clinicians and patients, COVID has shown that very well, it also is a very nice area to introduce complex problems that need to be solved using cutting-edge machine learning methods. So I often say that medicine and healthcare create new advances in machine learning, which can then be used in other applications beyond medicine and healthcare. I'd like to start by thanking my research team, my brilliant students and postdoc that have contributed to the research I'm presenting to you here. I'll start with a brief quote from Sir William Osler, which is the father of modern medicine. If it were not for the great variability between individuals, medicine might as well be a science, not an art. And indeed, my group is developing machine learning methods to move medicine from art to science. New machine learning methods aimed at delivering bespoke medicine, understanding the basis and trajectories of health and disease, empowering healthcare professionals as well as patients, informing and improving clinical pathways, enabling better utilization of resources and reducing healthcare costs, transforming population health and public health policies, and enabling new discoveries. I'm going to highlight many of these topics today. And our research agenda focuses on several areas. First, as I'm going to discuss a little bit later towards the very end of this talk, in order in machine learning for healthcare to make a contribution, we need to have high quality healthcare data sets. And that is tricky because unlike in the case of ImageNet, where we can go and collect more images of cats or dogs and so on, in healthcare, this is very sensitive because this is sensitive healthcare data that shouldn't just be dumped into the public domain. But also we cannot just go and gather more data at will. The data is whatever we have from the patients that have been having a particular condition. So an important machine learning topic is that of generating high quality synthetic data with high fidelity as well as high privacy guarantees. And the problem of synthetic data generation is a very important machine learning problem that I'm going to briefly discuss at the end of this presentation. And if you are interested to learn more about that, I've given together with my postdoc at ICML 2021 a tutorial on synthetic data generation that can be found online. So how to build generative models for complex multi-dimensional and complex data sets in healthcare with high privacy and high fidelity guarantees. Most of the talk today will focus on developing analytics, whether it's treatment effects, forecasting, transfer learning, AutoML. Then if we have such analytics, we would like that these analytics are really truly useful for patients and clinicians. So the analytics need to be interpretable and also need to come with uncertainty estimates, such that the clinicians and patients know when they can trust the models and when they cannot. I'm going to talk about interpretability and uncertainty quantification as well. Finally, a topic that I'm not going to discuss today, but hopefully in a future AIDA seminar, is a new branch of machine learning that we are building that we call quantitative epistemology, which is really a new field of interdisciplinary research that's very much focused on machine learning and aiming at conceiving a new human-machine partnership. And let me just say that the key idea here is that unlike right now, very often we use analytics and black box machine learning that we try to understand using interpretability methods. Here we do quite the reverse. We use machine learning to understand the human brain, to understand how humans make decisions, how they decide to acquire and integrate information, and how they can use this decision process to issue decisions. We know that medicine is actually very diverse and there is a lot of variation in practice, and machine learning can help us understand how clinicians arrive to conclusions with the goal not of replacing them by imitating them, but rather by empowering, understanding their decision process with a goal of empowerment. As part of building these tools that I'm going to describe here today, we have a lot of interactions with clinicians. As a matter of fact, we have a series of engagement sessions that is only open to clinicians, but which we have posted online. So if you are interested in understanding how clinicians think, how they think about these problems and what type of tools they need, please take a look at these engagement sessions, which are online. I said in the beginning that we would like to go beyond precision medicine or personalized medicine to bespoke medicine. Patients are complex, and this translates to different risks, variation in symptoms, health and disease trajectories, and responses to treatment. And precision and personalized medicine, as we know it today, usually fits the patient to a given pattern on the basis of some static information, for instance, genotypic information. So on the basis of the genotypic information, the patient is fitted to a pattern. In bespoke medicine, we go one step further by recognizing and adapting to changes in patterns over time as the patient is aging, may change their lifestyle. Some new conditions, morbidities, comorbidities, or COVID may occur, as well as the patient may have different types of treatments. So this pattern identification and understanding, as well as making forecasts about changes in patterns, is necessary to really deliver bespoke medicine. And how we can do that? Using machine learning. An important example that I'd like to give here, but this is not the only one, but it's one that we work a lot on, is cancer, where over the trajectory of a patient from the moment the patient is born and has a particular genetic risk for developing cancer, all the way to potentially developing cancer, treatments, and so on, it is a complex journey where machine learning can contribute a lot. If you are interested in cancer in particular, you can see our website where we have a lot of these resources dedicated to machine learning for cancer. But this story is not only true for cancer, this is true for many diseases. And often we start with one disease, but we try to generalize from there and understand whether the lessons can be extrapolated to other diseases. What I'm going to talk about today is time series, because as you see in the cancer example, this is a very important and multifaceted problem. And of course, people have looked at time series models for a very, very long time, even before machine learning. What I plan to do today is to show to you how in medicine, we need to start to look differently at these very conventional and well-studied problems, and why it pushes us to develop new insights and new machine learning methods. I'm going in the beginning part of the presentation to introduce methods for time series models that are targeting different types of healthcare challenges. And then in the second part of my talk, I'm going to discuss how we can make time series models as useful as possible for clinicians and patients. If you want to read more about this entire research agenda, you can look at our website under research pillars to time series, and you can see some of the work I refer to here. So let me start with the first part, where I'm going to discuss some healthcare challenges that have motivated new machine learning models. So often what we have at our disposal is electronic health record data, as well as clinical knowledge. And on the basis of this, we would like to build disease progression models that are helping us to understand and model carefully the available data. So we are able to build such machine learning models for which we are learning on the basis of the electronic health record data parameters. And then we are using these models at test time, at runtime, to make predictions for the patient in front of the clinician. The focus is not only forecasting, but also understanding new views about disease, disease progression, both at the population level, at the subgroup level, and even at the individual patient level. So it's both about forecast, but also new understandings. An example is highlighted here. In the setting of a hospital care, you see many, many measurements that are collected about the patient that's in the hospital. This patient may have COVID, and we have multiple streams of measurements. The measurements are sparse and irregularly and at times informatively sampled. I'm going to touch upon that a little bit later. We may have multiple outcomes of interest, and I'll touch on that as well. So we often may not just want to say, is this person going to die or not? Or is this person going to enter ICU or not? But the questions may be more complex. Also, unfortunately, we may not observe the underlying state of the patient. So we may not, for instance, observe the onset of cancer or the onset of the patient having sepsis. We also have many different ways in which patterns can deteriorate. The patients are very diverse, as I was mentioning. So what we want is to have a data-driven, accurate, and interpretable model for forecasting. Usually, if you look in the clinical literature, state-of-the-art research is still using Markov models. And there are many disadvantages for that. First, they are assuming that we can observe the stage of the disease of the patient, which often we cannot. And often they may model this one disease at a time. And this is often done for the average patient. So there is one Markov model for the entire population for an entire disease. Of course, advances can be made, and we can use good old models such as hidden Markov models, which already are an advance because we are no longer just looking at observations, but also are inferring on the basis of this observation the underlying disease stage of the patient. And we can look at how many states, we can do model selection, we can look at the transition probabilities. So on the basis of, for instance, clinical findings, lab measurements, we can infer the staging of disease. And this may sound simple, but it is actually by itself very important because for many diseases, we do not know how many states a patient may pass through and whether the genetic information, for instance, of the patient may predispose this patient to transit much more fast among the different stages. But this is not enough because history matters. Such hidden Markov models ignore the history, which is very important in medicine. What states has the patient has been? What order of the states? How long a patient has been in a particular state? All of that matters. Also, as I mentioned, we want to move from a population model to a personalized model. So would something like recurrent neural networks, which have been very successful in natural language processing, help? Well, the trouble is that we want to have not only accurate forecasts, but also we want to have good understanding of the disease progression mechanism, such that the clinicians and patients can understand the latent structure of the disease evolution, potential causal pathways, as well as understanding phenotypes. So if you look at really recurrent neural networks, this is often not ideal because they may lead to uninterpretable predictions and uninterpretable latent structures. Observable models may also not be ideal, and other variations such as retain, which is a particular machine learning model developed a few years back, may lead to interpretable predictions because attention mechanisms are put on top of the different observations, but uninterpretable latent structures, thereby being not useful and actionable for clinicians who want to understand the underlying state that the patient is in and when they may move to a next state. So just looking at predictions and predictions over time may at times not be enough. So what we have done a few years back, and this is a powerful idea, not only in this current incarnation, but more generally, a very powerful idea is to combine the power of machine learning, deep learning, in this case, recurrent neural networks, which are very powerful at learning representations from data, with the interpretable structure of statistical models. So what we do here is we combine hidden Markov models with recurrent neural networks to create a general and versatile deep probabilistic model that is able to capture such complex non-stationary representation at the patient level. So on one hand, the emission probabilities are like in a hidden Markov model, so hence interpretable, but the transitions are non-stationary and learn through a recurrent neural network. In this way, we built a new type of attention mechanism. Unlike in a recurrent neural network, conventional attention mechanisms look at features. Here, the attention mechanisms are not on features, but rather on states. And the attention weights will determine the influences of past state realizations on future realizations. And the patient context really is updating the attention weights to focus on past states. So we know how much information and the fact that the patient has been in a past state in the past led to the current transition at the current time. In this way, these attentive state-space models overcome the shortcomings of Markov models because these attention weights create a soft version of a non-stationary variable order Markov model where the underlying dynamic of a patient changes over time depending on the individual's context, which may contain both static information, such as genetic information, as well as the weights so far. So how far the different, how much the different states have contributed so far. So in these models, the memory is shaped by both the patient's current context, clinical events, but also transitions, transition over times, and even as I'm going to show later, treatments. So in this way, we create a generalization through attentive state-space models of other classes of models that have seen in the past. Hidden Markov model, hidden semi-Markov models, variable order Markov models, deep Markov models. And here I'm just highlighting some of our own work that has used these different classes of models in the past for medicine. Why you want such a versatile model is because you'd like to uncover from data in a data-driven way how much memory you really need to consider when modeling disease trajectories for a particular class of patients or disease. And it may be that the attentive state space model becomes just a hidden Markov model, and that is enough for this class of the patient, of patients, but not for another. Let me now move one step further and say that often we don't just want to make one prediction. We want to look at multiple events of interest. So for instance, a patient that is elderly may have multiple competing risks. So we have past observations of the patient, different symptoms and lab signs, as measured, for instance, whenever the patient is going to see their general practitioner. And what we would like is to do time to event analysis to determine over time, as we acquire more data, will this patient have a heart attack? What's the probability of this patient developing this particular cancer or another related cancer? So the focus here is to measure really what we call a dynamic cumulative incidence function or a dynamic CIF, which looks at the longitudinal measurements that we have so far. And we are predicting on the basis of this, what is the probability of a patient developing in the future a particular type of event of interest K. So we look at multiple events of interest at the same time. This goes beyond state of the art in survival analysis, which looks at the static setting, so looks at current variables and just predicts different types of events of interest. Here we generalize to the dynamic setting, where over time we issue probabilities of certain events and we see how this change over time. So we are estimating the incidence of the occurrence of an event while taking different competing risks into account. So we do a joint estimation of different competing risks. How do we learn that? We learn that with architectures that are different than in conventional prediction for conventional prediction problems, because now we need to model different causes differently. So we may have a shared subnetwork that models the different factors jointly, but needs to predict the different outcomes differently from each other through cause-specific subnetworks. So like in a multitask architecture, and unlike in a conventional multitask architecture, we need, because these different risks are competing and interacting with each other, the loss functions need to be very carefully crafted, because we have a log likelihood of join time to event distribution that plays a role. We need to have a ranking loss that looks at the different events and what's their probabilities of occurrence. And finally, we have this third loss, which generalizes and penalizes the error over time. So here is where, again, medicine, and this shows a very interesting problem, where different types of loss functions need to be carefully crafted to capture these different aspects of this competing time to events and their interactions over time. This is shown in here. So what you see at different moments in time, you see a patient that is evolving over time. So it's first gone to the doctor at age 40, and then it's going every year to the doctor. And what you see is the probabilities of risks for breast cancer and cardiovascular disease being predicted. And what you see is that at some moment in time, this patient was having breast cancer. Then you see another patient on the right, which is a sensor patient, is a patient that disappeared from the data set. And one thing that's very important in this type of settings is, even though we do not have labels on the right set, right patient, we do not have, we do not know what has happened to this rightly censored patient, we still know that they have been alive and they did not have the event of interest, breast cancer and cardiovascular, by age 58. So this is a patient we need to learn from. So again, unlike in the conventional predictive setting, we need to learn from such right censoring. Other methods can be built, and here is another example, not a deep learning example like the dynamic deep hit, but rather a method that's built on Bayesian non-parametric survival models. Let me now talk about yet something different, clustering. So often two patients may look the same, but actually they experience very different events. So conventional notions of clustering and clustering over time through dynamic type warping, autoencoders, look in an unsupervised way at the similarity of patients, and often they do not provide guidance for medicine. What we need instead is to have a new notion of clustering that looks not only at similarities in the data, but also similarity in the outcomes. So two patients may look quite different, yet their probabilities of experiencing events of interest are quite similar. So hence they need to be clustered similarly, because even though patient A and patient C may look different, they will experience similar events over time. So we would like to do that, to inform patients and their clinicians about subsequent adverse events. For instance, in cancer, where even two patients, again, may look similar, would maybe experience recurrence at the same time. So for that, we move from the current notion of clustering and phenotyping that is predictive, that is purely based on the observations in an unsupervised way, into one where we are looking at predictions of similar events over time. And this is what you see in this past ICML paper, where we developed a method that is learning discrete representations of past observations that are best describing future events of interest. So we learn what events of interest, what data and when should be acquired to tell us something significant about the evolution of this particular cancer patient, for instance. So this outcome-oriented temporal phenotyping is contrasted here with the traditional notion of phenotyping. So in the traditional notion of phenotyping, two patients are going to be considered similar just because they are close to each other in the embedding space. However, in this new notion of outcome-oriented phenotyping, even though they may be in the same phenotype and they may have experienced different outcomes, they may be quite different in the representation space. So how can we learn that? How can we learn that they are actually going to have similar outcomes? We learn that through a reinforcement learning framework, where the embeddings are actually learned to be related to each other, not due to just being close in the embedding space, but being close in the outcome space. And in this way, the actor is providing embeddings, and the critic is judging these embeddings on the basis of subsequent predictions and subsequent events of interest. Let me now move to another idea of screening and monitoring. So often we have a patient that maybe has developed cancer, and we want to identify when should we monitor this patient next to determine, for instance, recurrence. So the question is, what's the value of information? Who should we monitor? How often shall we monitor? And what type of observations shall we gather? This is true both for screening before somebody has developed cancer, as well as afterwards. So here is a set of papers that present different types of ideas. And I think that this area is still very much an area in the research stage. And I'm going to just present you one idea, but I think much more can and should be done. And the idea here is to use active sensing to learn what's the value of acquiring information. So monitoring and screening is costly. Going and getting an additional MRI or an additional measurement about the patient is costly. So we need to learn to trade off the value of acquiring this information. If we have this information, we can issue better predictions, so we have value, but there is cost associated with acquiring this information. So we need to realize that sensing is an active choice. The challenge though here is that we do not know in advance how valuable it is for a class of patients to acquire information and when. This needs to be learned. So the idea here is that we build neural networks that learn and training time for different classes of patients, cost performance, cost valuation points. And to do that, what we in effect do is we have a two-step approach. We take a data, and the data in the data set, the data may be missing according to whatever we have in the electronic health record. But we try to say, what happens if we would throw away data in different ways? We throw more and more data away in a principled way and try to learn, would we still be able to predict if we don't have this information? So at the training stage, we learn different representations with different cost-benefits trade-offs to learn to operate at different points. Then at runtime, we have a new patient, and we are going to learn this we use these representations to determine, shall we acquire a new information for this patient within the next time horizon, or it is sufficient to predict by imputing the information in this next observations. And if we impute, what will be the prediction performance? And if we acquire information, how much we would benefit from it? And note that to know that, we need these different representations because we need to be able to evaluate the potential benefit of information acquisition. Part of the puzzle is not only determining when to monitor and how to monitor and how much to monitor, but can use this information to do early diagnosis. And this is another area where I feel a lot more as a machine learning community and AI community we can add. To illustrate why we need to do better, let me take the example I showed before of this attentive state space model. So let's assume we learn this attentive state space model and we learn transition and transition probabilities across the different states. For instance, we have learned that we have a particular symptom that's on this particular patient on our training set that's available at the moment, time three. Then at four, we have a comorbidity that's diagnosed. And then at stage three, we suddenly have a patient that has developed cancer. If we now have such annotated data, what we can do then at test time, whenever we see a patient with a symptom of interest, like the symptom highlighted here, we may be able to predict early that this patient is having a probability that's quite high after a certain time horizon to develop cancer. If the probability is high, we may decide to monitor this patient more aggressively, give additional tests, recommend a lifestyle change. How to do that in the most comprehensive way, still an important area of research. I talked a lot about predictions, but what about interventions? Could we, for instance, determine at a certain moment in time to intervene and provide, for instance, to a patient a recommendation to do chemotherapy, radiotherapy, to stop treatment or to change to another treatment? This is no longer a prediction problem, but rather a causal inference problem. We need to decide how to treat, when to give treatment, and potentially when to stop treatment. So what we have at our disposal now in the data set is patient features, both static as well as dynamic observations over time. And we also have now interventions, treatments over time. This represents the data set and the patient history. And what we will try to estimate is what intervention we should be giving to this patient that leads to the best outcome. The challenge, though, is in the data set, we do have only access to the factual outcomes. We do not observe counterfactuals. We do not know what would have happened to this patient if we would have treated them differently in the past. So we need to build a causal inference model here. And this is challenging, because we need to deal with time-dependent confounders, which are biasing the treatment assignment in the observational data set. What are these type of time-dependent confounders? Are patient covariates that are affected by the past treatment, which then influence future treatment and outcomes. For instance, side effects. And you see here how, for instance, we can capture bias from time-dependent confounders. But this is complicated in the time series setting. It's already complicated in the in the static setting. It's even more complex in the time-dependent setting. The conventional way to think about that for many years has been to use marginal structural models, as developed by Robbins, Hernan, and Brumbach almost 20 years ago. More recently, we have developed machine learning-based methods that are learning more complex representations for data, so we empower these marginal structural models with recurrent neural networks. But both these models are learning based on inverse probability of treatment weighting and learn to deal with this bias through learning representations that are weighing differently depending on the probability of treatment. The challenge, though, of both the original models, the marginal structural models, as well as our own advanced, is that when we don't have a lot of patients, and often we do not have a lot of patients, they are numerically unstable and lead to high variance. So more recently, we use a different way of looking at this problem of time-dependent confounding bias in the time series setting through counterfactual recurrent neural networks, where we learn balanced representations through deep learning. How do we do that? We take two powerful ideas in the literature and we combine them. We use these ideas from sequence-to-sequence architecture that have been very powerful in natural language processing, where we often learn to translate from one language to another through sequence-to-sequence architectures. But the challenge here is more complex, because while you can view moving from one language, if you like, to another language by intervening, by doing treatment, so you can almost view metaphorically the patient before treatment or while given a particular treatment was translated into a different language post-treatment. This is challenging because, unlike in natural language processing, we need to deal with bias. Natural language processing and sequence-to-sequence models don't deal with these bias problems. So how do we deal with that? By learning domain adversarial representations. And this is more highlighted in this paper I'm capturing here, but we need to do this domain adversarial training over time and make sure that at every moment in time where we can introduce a new treatment or change the treatment, we indeed are able to debias through domain adversarial training. Let me now talk briefly about how we can make such models useful in practice. First, we can choose a variety of machine learning models. I showed you attentive state space models, but many architectures exist. And as the data is changing, we may need to learn different types of models. And the best model for each time step may be different. And we can't do that by hand. Ideally, we want to do this using automated machine learning. And automated machine learning has done great progress for static setting. But for time series setting, this problem has not been much tackled till relatively recently. And this is a challenging problem, as I'm going to show to you next. Because we have time series, at every moment in time, potentially, the model may be changing. But if we change the model, this has also an impact into the future. So we would like to select new models in a stepwise fashion while taking care about the performance of the prediction at the current moment in time, but also into the future. So a few years back, we developed a model that we call stepwise model selection to enable us to do sequence prediction. And for that, as I'm going to show to you, we developed a new way of doing Bayesian optimization to tackle such model selection. So why is this problem challenging in the time series setting? Because we have multiple functions that we need to optimize over time. So we need to do model performance estimation at each time step. And this becomes, to some extent, a multi-objective Bayesian optimization where different objectives are at different moments in time. And we need to find one model that does the best trade-off across all these objectives. But formalizing this problem as a multi-objective Bayesian optimization doesn't solve the problem, because if we formalize it in this way, it is unsolvable due to the associated complexity. So are there other solutions? Well, one way to think about that is to model this as a multitask Bayesian optimization, where we can use information at the past moment in time to warm start the future moments in time, thereby transferring knowledge from previous optimizations. But the disadvantage of this idea is that if we formalize it in this way, this requires evaluating deep learning models on large data sets, which is expensive. And it requires solving T separate Bayesian optimizations procedures in a sequence, and it is unclear how to allocate the evaluations, and doesn't take full advantage on the information that the Bayesian optimization is solving across the different acquisition functions over time. So what we proposed in this work is this new way of looking at the problem, where we solve the multiple black box optimization functions jointly and efficiently by learning and exploiting the correlations across these black box functions using a deep kernel learning. So this is why we call this problem stepwise model selection via deep kernel learning. How do we do that? We use deep kernel learning to create feature feature maps to measure the similarities between the data tuples. And then, and then at the next step, we are learning using these deep sets how these similarities exist across the different data sets with different lengths over time. And then finally, we use a multi-layer perceptron that is taking the input data, XT, over time, looks at the similarities of what has been done for similar data sets in the past, and provides as an output the hyperparameters that are useful, the model selection that's useful for this particular data set. Let me now talk briefly about interpretability of time series models. While a lot of models exist for static interpretability, LIME, SHAP, Learning to Explain, and many others, we have ourselves built a lot of work on model interpretability, and you can take a look at our website if you are interested in that. How to do time series interpretability is really very different. And this is recent work that we have published at ICML 2021, where we show that if it is to take conventional methods like LIME or SHAP, they are very brittle in the time series setting. You cannot fix these models for the time series setting to learn consistent feature importance that truly can explain what a deep learning model has learned. So instead, what we do here is we learn dynamic masks that are robust to the time series setting. Please take a look if you are interested. Again, this is a very begin area. Time series interpretability is still the next frontier. I hope many of you will join this research agenda. Now, we don't want only to interpret. We also may want to have new understanding on the basis of time series data. A good example is learning how different diseases affect and impact new diseases. And morbidity and comorbidity networks are very important in medicine. State of the art currently suffers from two limitations. First is one size fits all, it's population level. So one network is built across the entire set of patients. But an even bigger problem is that the models are static. So one comorbidity network is built and it remains the same over time. Instead, what we have done recently is we use machine learning models to learn how the emergence of some morbidities may or may not impact the emergence of other morbidities. So we model this network as a dynamic network that's influenced by the timing and the probability of occurrence of past morbidities. So we model this through a deep diffusion process that models the temporal relationships between comorbid disease onsets through a dynamic graph. This is very powerful for understanding, but also for intervention, because we know that if we didn't intervene on time to prevent a certain morbidity from happening, this may lead to subsequent diseases over time. So this enables us to model these events as a multidimensional point process with an intensity functions that parameterized by the edges of this dynamic graph. Now, we may issue predictions, but we also want to have uncertainty estimates associated with these predictions. And actually, this is a very underrepresented area. Very little work exists on building confidence estimates for recurrent neural networks. So what we would like is to understand over time the confidence intervals associated with our machine learning models, for instance, recurrent neural networks. Last year, we developed a method which provides us frequentist uncertainty for recurrent neural networks via blockwise influence functions. And the idea here is that the uncertainty intervals are capturing the variability in the resample recurrent neural network outputs. So we do what's shown in here. We do this type of block deletion, and then we are creating RNN outputs as resampled solutions by perturbing the model parameters through this iterative deletion of blocks of data and then retraining the model on the remaining parts. In this way, through this model retraining on these different perturbed models, we are able to create confidence estimates associated with this particular prediction model. This is superior to existing alternatives such as Bayesian recurrent neural networks based on, for instance, Monte Carlo dropout, which are not able to provide confidence frequentist guarantees, but only credible intervals. So this is a problem for medicine because often we want to have true coverage. It's not enough to just have credible intervals. Moreover, such methods based on Bayesian solutions, based on dropout, are often overconfident in terms of predictions. And also other models such as quantile RNNs or probabilistic RNNs. Another advantage is not only that we can have frequentist guarantees, but also this can be done in a post hoc way, unlike, for instance, Bayesian Monte Carlo dropout. So it does not affect the model accuracy and does not interfere with model training, is general and versatile, and as I mentioned, provides formal frequentist procedures. Now, what about missing data? Just very briefly. Well, one way in which we can deal with missing data, because we know that we may not observe information at all moments in time, is to build on conventional bidirectional neural networks. And this is what we did in this early work, where we are interpolating the missing data both over time through temporal correlations as well as across features. So the reason we call it multidirectional is because we impute both within a stream and across stream. This is one way to do that, and a simple way to do that. But the disadvantage of doing just that is that it considers that missing data is completely at random and not informative. So we could do better than that. We can do better by realizing that missingness of data in healthcare is not at random. We can learn from missing information. So we can learn from clinical judgments. So again, a few years back, we develop a technology where we are looking at informative sampling and we build probabilistic models that are able to learn from such clinical judgments. For instance, by modeling a patient trajectory as a mark point process that's modulated by their health states. So for instance, if a patient has a lot of observations, this says something about the underlying state the patient is in. And use Hox point processes as a way to model and capture that, which will inform us about the data. So we are learning not only from the observations, from the value of the observations, but also from the missingness pattern. And again, in this particular work, we are doing that by using these Hox point processes, which are generalization of Poisson point processes, these doubly stochastic point processes that are able to capture the impact of health state on clinician sampling behavior. Finally, I want to just briefly talk about synthetic data, just very briefly. So all of this is beautiful that I'll discuss till now, but it cannot be possible unless we have high quality data sets. And the reality is that in machine learning right now, we have very few publicly available data sets. Mimic is one such data set, but this is one of the very few data sets. And the reason we cannot have easy access to healthcare data is due to strict regulation for data access that are the result of perfectly valid concerns provided by HIPAA and GDPR. And this is, of course, understandable, but this impedes us as machine learning researchers. So one solution that has been proposed in the past, which is not a successful solution, is to do de-identification and anonymization. And the trouble with de-identification anonymization is that often either the data that's anonymized through these old-fashioned technologies is useless by the time we are getting it because there is nothing useful remaining into it, or conversely, the data, and this is more often the case, the data has been anonymized badly and patients can be re-identified. And the press is full of such examples. So what we propose here instead is to use machine learning to build synthetic data this data created from scratch and cannot be synced back to an individual if modeled properly. But what's challenging is this represents a new machine learning frontier because we need to use new machine learning models, generative models that are capable to learn such data from the available real data. I will not discuss that in view of time, but if you are interested in building new types of generative models from GANs to Fourier flows, please take a look at this recent tutorial, which discusses what are the challenges, what are existing solutions, and where we hope to go as a community next. Finally, if you are wanting to play with this type of technologies, we have built an open resource that's called Clairvoyance that contains many of the solutions that I presented here, from personalized monitoring to personalized treatment effects. And you can read more about that in this paper and find the software on our website, and you can enhance on it, build on it, and take this research agenda to a next level. Of course, the research agenda goes beyond what I just discussed here, because it's not only about the different blocks taken separately, but also how they interact. And finally, if you are interested in developing machine learning models for healthcare, we have developed a set of engagement sessions where we would like to discuss with AI researchers like you, how can we build tools that could be truly useful for healthcare. So I hope you are going to join one of our future sessions. Thank you very much.